Hi there, friends. I'm Vasco. I'm part of the team behind the first global Scrum Master Summit. If you're a Scrum Master, the Scrum Master Summit is a place to learn, to share, and to meet new friends. We will have lots of live sessions where you can meet and network with other Scrum Masters from all over the globe. So make sure you check it at bit.ly/SM Summit and the numeral 21. That's bit.ly/SMSUMMIT21. We have 7 amazing keynotes or more, as we are still organizing the conference as I record this, and 8 tracks that feature people like you and thought leaders sharing their insights and knowledge to help you become an awesome Scrum Master. So once again, check it out at bit.ly/SM Summit 21. That's all lowercase, all one word, SM Summit and the numeral 21. I'll see you on the virtual conference floor. All right, now on to the show. Hello, everybody. Welcome to our Thursday, Success Thursday, this week with Wouter Gijsen. Hi, Wouter. Welcome back.
So glad to be back.
Absolutely. It's a pleasure to have you. And today is Thursday, of course. We will talk about success in a second. But first, share with us, what's your favorite retrospective format and why?
Well, my favorite retrospective format is the Sailboat. It's one of the... Every time when I work with a new team, the first retrospective is the Sailboat. And the reason, because it's a fun way. It's working really with a metaphor. And it's for many teams where I come in as a Scrum Master, it's something new. Most of the time, they've been working with what went well, what could be improved, what could be different, mad, glad, sad, those kind of retrospective formats. But the moment you come in with the sailboat, it's visual. You have the wind, the sun, the boat, the rocks, the sharks. You can go really wild with drawing and be very visual. And that's something that I really like. And for a lot of teams, it's something completely new. It breaks also the pattern of the usual, typical, what I would say, more boring retrospective formats.
Yeah, absolutely. The couple of things you said. So first, it's a lot of fun, and it is, especially if the teams get really excited and involved with the drawing and the improving of the picture, because that's part of the game as well. But also because it's a metaphor, it helps us talk about things sometimes without us even knowing that we are talking about things. You know, somebody will mention something, one of the rocks that we have that, you know, is threatening the boat and may sink the boat is the code review process. And somebody else will look at it like, huh, that's a good point. I thought I was being very thorough with the code review, but maybe what I'm doing is keeping my team from, you know, performing, right? And this type of conversation can happen because it's not offensive, right? It's not you did something wrong. It's talking about that rock or the wind in our sails or the anchor or, you know, the island that we're trying to reach with the boat. I think that the aspect that it is a metaphor helps both with the fun as well as to approach difficult subjects in a safe way. What do you think about that?
Indeed, those metaphors, there are also quite a lot in one format. So you have, like you said, the wind helping the team forward. You have the sun, the positive elements, but also the team goal, the island. What is the end point? What do we want to reach? That's something that most of the teams are not aware of. They just get their user stories, and then they start thinking, okay, what is actually our goal as a team? What's our purpose? So that brings it to a whole other level. And what you also can do with the sailboat, and that's something what's real nice add-on, is that you can identify the rocks or the sharks on different level. So you can go on team level, but also on inter-team level. So how is our way of working with other teams? Can we improve there? What are there the risks or the sharks? But also on the whole organization, So you can bring in different layers of deepness on communications, on conversations in one picture, one element. And yeah, pasting post-its and moving post-its is always fun, of course.
Also because it helps people get up and move, which creates energy, right?
Yeah. And that's something that I really want to emphasize when I'm working with teams. Now with Corona, it's a bit less, of course, but still there are nice formats you can do in those whiteboards. But it's really having people moving, pasting post-its, talk to each other in groups, in one big group, in smaller groups, so that they really are talking to each other rather than just a retrospective where everyone is just saying, okay, this sprint, I did that and I noticed the code was not so good. And then what can we do about it? Okay, we'll discuss it in the next sprint. But there's no energy in it. And I really want to have powerful, energetic retrospectives.
Yeah, that's a good point. Powerful and energetic retrospectives are a big plus. All right, Wouter, thank you for sharing that. Now we turn our attention to what we do and what success means. So share with us, what's your definition of success for the Scrum Master's job?
Well, that is a very difficult question. You can look at it from different angles. You can take success as a team, which is delivering. So you can take the ratio between committed user stories and delivered stories. Is that good? Is that not so good? That can, from there, you can measure how the team is going and also extend it how you are working as a Scrum Master. But then you're more like a delivery master than just a Scrum Master. On the other side, it's hard to, as a Scrum Master, I see myself as the glue between the team, between the organization, between the PO and the team. So sometimes it's invisible, and it's something that always I'm often struggling with is, am I doing the right things? Am I being successful as a Scrum Master? Because it's not always that visible. Of course, in the story I already told about delivering the demos, presenting the demos, there you can see there's some success. You achieved something, but it's always not always very visible what you do as a Scrum Master. And that's something that I often struggle with. And PO, my previous PO, told me once a story about if a lady brings coffee to the team, and the team can work in a better way because she brings coffee to the team, is she then contributing successfully to the team? And is she part of the team? Is that a success? So that's something I'm really thinking often about. What are you doing as a Scrum Master that brings you success to the team and makes you successful as well? So it's something that I'm really struggling with, to really quantify what is actually my contribution to the team and to their success. Because I'm a serving servant, so a serving leader. I'm there for the team, so I make them successful, but it's hard to show them really what makes me successful or what brings me success as a Scrum Master.
Indeed, the role of the Scrum Master is one of helping others succeed, and I think therein lies one of the difficulties of measuring success for us, the Scrum Masters. You share two perspectives, that of the delivery, when the team is able to deliver and answer the commitments they have made, and also that of being the glue, being the entity that brings the team and the stakeholders together, helping them to work well in order to then reach the delivery. I think those are also great perspectives to take as Scrum Master, and maybe to do a reflection for ourselves as Scrum Masters every Friday, once a week, whatever that might be, just to make sure that we are still focusing on what matters, because it is easy to kind of get lost in the day-to-day activities and forget that we are there to help the team deliver.
That's correct. And also, if you, for example, a programmer at the end of the week, you can, for example, say, okay, I wrote 200 lines of code, which is working and tested. But as a Scrum Master, at the end of the week, you can say, okay, what did I do? Okay, I had lots of coaching talks. I had talks with people to improve them. I listened to complaints. I listened to the PO who wants to mention something. So it's not always very tangible what you are doing.
Yeah, absolutely. This was a very in-depth discussion about success, but one that is really important for us as Scrum Masters. I mean, after all, we do need to think about it if we are to reach success. So thank you very much for sharing this with us, Wouter.
With all pleasure.
Part of a successful Scrum Master job is to help the product owner. Tomorrow we explore that critical role in Scrum, the product owner role. Tune in to learn about product owner anti-patterns, what you can do to help the product owner, and a real-life example of what a great product owner is and what made it so. Tomorrow on our Friday Product Owner episode. See you tomorrow. We really hope you liked our show. And if you did, why not rate this podcast on Stitcher or iTunes? Share this podcast and let other Scrum Masters know about this valuable resource for their work. Remember that sharing is caring.